those computers. Praise the Lord, Brother Revalee, and take it away.
Well, I'm glad to be here with you all, with the Spirit-Filled Church of Cedar Rapids Metropolitan. Thank you all for being part of the Zoom conversation here, being part of this service here from vast distances across America. We are at times separated by miles, but we are united in the Holy Ghost. And so from Tennessee to Michigan, Iowa, and to everybody here on this Zoom call, thank you for being open to the moving of the Holy Ghost wherever you are. Sister Crow, would you pray over the service tonight before I get going?
Thank you, Jesus. Yeah. Thank you, Lord, for bringing us all together through the wonder of technology, Lord, that we can enjoy a word fitly spoken, Lord, from Brother Revalee. And we ask that you would bless every single person on this call. And not only that, everyone that sees the recording, give them a great blessing and revelation. And a view of your kingdom, Lord, in Jesus' name.
Yes, and to the Trevinos in Minnesota, and Penny in Minnesota, and Ruby Lynn in...
they'll all be watching.
...overseas, and yes, and to the group in Greece, the Lord bless you and keep you.
All right. I'll begin this evening right in the Word of God. So if you have your Bibles, please turn to Ephesians chapter 6. I'm going to begin at verse number 10. And while you're turning, let me say a special thing.
Be strong in the Lord.
Thank you, Pastor and Sister Krogh, for the invitation to minister here. Thank you, Pastor Freeze, all the ministers who are a part of this service right here, and to everybody who's going to watch this service later online. I pray the blessing of the Lord on your life. And even if you play this message several days later, may the Holy Ghost move in you and speak a direct prophetic word over you in Jesus' name. Let it not be Joel Revalee who preaches this sermon, but let it be you, Jesus, who speaks through me. I submit my vessel to you, Lord God, and have your way in this Zoom call in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. So Ephesians 6, I'll begin at verse number 10. And I'll give you all a moment to turn. Once you're all there, say amen or give a thumbs up there on the Zoom videos. Hallelujah. Okay. I'll read about three or four verses here. Finally, my brethren, you know, whenever a man says, finally, you have to hear the full volume of that man's voice when he says that word. It's like he's putting his apostle fist down. Like, this is the closing argument of this letter. In the epistle of Ephesians, which means the letter of the Ephesians, these are the final words. This is the final chapter, chapter 6. And so this is part of his final series of statements to this church. So what did he save to close out this letter? He saves one of the most important revelations of the New Testament right here. Finally, my brothers, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. See, power comes from God's might, not my own strength. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Now, while I do believe we wrestle all levels of demonic pushback in our lives, and the next verse even talks about that, do not discount that there are moments throughout your spiritual history where at times you have faced various elements of satanic attack throughout your lifespans, in Jesus' name. So in verse 12, it even describes several levels of demonic attack that are possible. We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. I could do a whole sermon on what those four levels of demonic warfare are, and I'll get into the Greek words and all that, but I'll save that for a different session. But those are there. There's different levels of attack a person can endure in their life. And depending on what you are enduring, as the saying is, new levels, new devils. And so if you felt like you've been in a season of enhanced attack, that means you've actually gone up a level in the kingdom of God. And hell sees you as a bigger threat than you ever have been before in your life. So receive that revelation in Jesus' name. Keep going there. Verse 13. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day. Now that phrase whole armor is a repeat. It says the whole armor in verse 11, put on the whole armor of God in verse 11, and then verse 13, it says it again. And when a preacher repeats himself, there's something deep there, something important he's saying. Take unto you the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand in the evil day. Implication being that partial armor is incomplete protection. That without the whole armor, you won't be able to withstand in the evil. Having done all, to stand. The verse 13 closes out by telling you to stand. And then from verse 14 on, we see a description of the armor of God. And I confess to you, I have preached the armor of God multiple times in many different churches. I have preached the six pieces of the armor of God. And normally, we teach this in Sunday school, right? We teach from the head down. The helmet is this. Breastplate is this. The belt is this. The shoes are that. The sword is this. And the shield is this. We teach from the head downward to the kids in Sunday school. Problem is, the order that we normally preach the armor of God in is not the scriptural order. And I confess to you that I have preached an incorrect, unbiblical order of God's armor right here in Ephesians chapter 6. And tonight, I would like to correct that. Tonight, if you indulge me, I'd like to preach to you on the correct order of the armor of God. If I have a title for this message, my title is The Order of the Armor. I'm going to call this message The Order of the Armor. We are told by the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, let all things be done decently and in order. We're also told by the mouth of Solomon, the king, who I believed was working in prophecy when he wrote these words in Ecclesiastes 3, to everything there is a season and a time for every purpose under the heavens. God is a God of order, of placement, of seasons, of times, and of purposes. There is a correct an order, a correct order of the operation of God. There is a reason why God does things that he does. There's a reason why God says things that he says. There's a reason why God does not say certain things that he does not say. There's a purpose in the words and a purpose in the absence or the silence of words in the order of God's statement. So tonight, before I say anything else, I want you to make this resolution to begin the new year, that you will not add to the words of God and you will not take away from the words of God. In fact, if I go deep here, let me say this. I think that's part of the identity of being apostolic. We are not denominational Christians. We don't change the salvation plan. We believe and preach repentance, baptism in Jesus' name, and the infilling of the Holy Ghost, because that is what the scriptures say in Acts 2:38, and in Acts chapter 8, and Acts chapter 10, and in Acts chapter 19, and Acts chapter 22. We are apostolic because we don't edit the Word of God for content. I take this book right here as it is. I thank God for the words of the pages in this book. I am saved because of this book right here. I am who I am because of the I am being who he is. And I thank God for his word and his intervention in your lives. Hallelujah. Feel the Holy Ghost right here on the World Wide Web. There's an order in these words here in Ephesians chapter 6. I want to begin in order, and I want to get right to this in the armor of God. Let me start out with the very first piece of the armor. And the first piece of the armor of God is a revelation. The order of this armor reveals the importance of God's protection on you, the Christian, but it also reveals the order of what Satan and demons attack first. And what demons attack first is interesting, and what God protects first is very interesting. Ephesians 6 and 4, verse 14, the very first piece of armor. Stand, therefore, having your loins girt about with truth. The first piece of armor is the girding piece of the loins. Now, I will not get graphic here, but the loins are perhaps the most sensitive part of the anatomy. And in biology, the loins are associated with a very important concept. Reproduction. The loins are associated with reproduction. So why are you talking about this, Brother Revalee? I'm glad you asked. Let me tell you why. The first thing that demons want to take out is your ability to reproduce as a Christian. Hell is most threatened by your ability to reproduce yourself in the kingdom of God, your ability to evangelize and tell somebody else about the infilling of the Holy Ghost, and tell somebody else they need to get baptized in Jesus' name, and to tell somebody else that God can grant you repentance and forgiveness of all of your sins. Hell is threatened the greatest by your ability to reproduce and to witness to somebody else out there at your job, at the coffee shop, or at the bus station. You are a threat to hell every time you tell somebody that Jesus loves them and God is real and God can change their life. You shake the very gates of the enemy when you tell a new convert that God can clear the board and wash them in the blood of the Lamb. They can be baptized in the name of Jesus. You are punching hell's army line in the face when you give the Acts 2:38 message to somebody else in your city. And when you reach out in your community, that gospel salvation plan, you are doing damage to the enemy by reproducing yourself. Somebody's saying amen.
Amen. Amen.
So if hell hates it when we reproduce, then let me ask you and pose this question. What stops hell from canceling your reproduction power as a Christian? Your loins are girt about with what? What does it say there in Ephesians 6 and 14? Having your loins girt about with truth. Truth protects your ability to reproduce as a Christian. The truth of God. That's why, once again, I'm going to hammer this point because I want all of us to get this here tonight to start out this message. Truth is the spiritual immunization against hell's effort to sterilize you. Hell will love you to be unable to bring forth a new generation of baby Christians. What blocks hell's hand in your life from doing that is truth. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth and the life. Truth blocks hell from stopping you from reproducing. Truth stops hell from stopping you in evangelizing. That's why, once again, we hammer that we're apostolic. We don't change the message. We don't change the salvation plan. We don't change the word of God. So now invert this. When somebody veers off of truth, that is what sterilizes them as a Christian. When someone veers off of truth, that is what makes them spiritually infertile. When you see a life, when you see a ministry, I'm getting very controversial, but I feel this in the Holy Ghost. What stops someone from reproducing themselves as a Christian? When they veer off the course of truth, they become spiritually and ministerially infertile. And God is calling somebody who's watching this video online right now. God is calling somebody across the world wide web back to the message of truth, back to the apostolic fundamentals, back to the foundations of faith right here in this book. This book, being a foundational apostolic fundamental Christian, just preaching the truth, that will stop hell from stopping you reproducing as a Christian. Take 10 seconds right now and give God a good old-fashioned Pentecostal worship. Hallelujah! Wherever you go, Lord, I want to walk in truth. I want to be a man of truth tonight.
Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus.
Having your loins heard about with truth. If the enemy can make you leave, he makes you spiritually sterile. But if God can keep you in the truth,
yeah,
then you can continue to bring forth a new generation.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yes.
That's only the first piece of armor. Having your loins girded about with truth. It's the first and the very most important piece of armor Full stop. This is not how we do the armor of God if we were doing this in the flesh. If we were making the armor of God in the flesh, we put the helmet on first, right? The helmet is the fifth and ultimate piece of armor.
Yeah.
It's next to last. So our order and how we think God needs to protect our lives, that order is all skewed. And God is trying to reorient our holy minds and focus us on what the actual battle plan of hell is and what the actual defense plan of God is. Your first piece of armor is the loins piece, girded about with truth. And the second piece, having on the breastplate of righteousness. The breastplate. What does that protect? Your heart. The breastplate protects your heart. The first attack of hell is to your reproduction power as a Christian. The second attack of hell is to your heart. See, God is revealing to somebody what the plan of the enemy really is. The first plan of the enemy is to make you a one man or one woman act. And if hell can't do that, then hell's second plan is to make you a depressed, stressed, crazy train mess. And that is not the will of God. It is not the will of God for you to feel like an emotional basket case. It is not the will of God for you to be at your wit's end. It is not the will of God for your heart to be filled with poison and stress and pressure. It is not the will of God for you to feel like you're a spinning top on the whirly gig of emotions. That is not the plan of the Lord. Jesus said it in the Gospels. I come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. It is the will of God for you to have the abundant life. God said it in his word, and I wish we'd quote this verse more often. I would that ye prosper and be in health. In Deuteronomy, God even says, it is he that giveth us the power to get wealth. All these good things. Don't give those verses to the charismatics. Don't give those verses to prosperity. I believe those verses are the will of God for us in the apostolic and Pentecostal faith as well. I believe God does want you to have joy and peace and love. The first three fruit of the Spirit are love, joy, and peace. Those are the very first three fruit that you bring forth and bear as a Holy Ghost-filled believer. There is good and positive that God brings to pass in your life. The plan of the enemy. The plan of the enemy is to cancel all that. And if he can't stop you from reproducing, the second plan of the enemy is to attack your heart. I'm going to just fire off several verses here, and I hope you all brought your Bibles, your Bible apps, your iPads. So just follow along with me here. Proverbs chapter 4 and verse 23. Please keep a thumb on Ephesians 6. But Proverbs chapter 4 and verse number 23 says, keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. Now the next verse in Proverbs says, put away from thee froward mouth and perverse lips far from thee. Those two verses are related, by the way. It matters how you talk. Don't be running yourself down. Yeah, don't gossip about other people, but don't run yourself down either. Don't be part of healthy conversations, because that connects back to that previous verse about your heart, keeping your heart with all diligence. Perverse lips can poison you. You can run yourself down. You can say, oh, woe is me, like a spiritual Eeyore. You can say, woe is me, I'm having this. You can talk yourself down from your victory if you're not careful. That is why we're told in Philippians chapter 4, whatever things are good and lovely, if there be any virtue, think on these things. Focus on the good things that God has brought to pass in your life. David had to encourage himself in the Lord in a certain passage in the Old Testament. There are times where I may not be able to reach out to somebody else. I'm going to have to say, Lord, I still believe that you're a healer. ruler. I still believe you're Jehovah Jireh, my provider. God, you're Jehovah Mekadeshkim. You're the Lord, my Savior. God, you made water come out of that rock in a dry and thirsty land. And I'm in a dry and thirsty season. And you're still the God that can make water gush out of the rock. You can make streams in the desert in the season of my life. I believe in the power of God. Your heart. Heart matters. Protect your heart. You know, there are people and there are issues that are not worth your heart. And that sounds tough. And that sounds controversial. I'm not apologizing for saying that. Because if you're not careful, you will spend all of your time and you'll waste all of your heart on things that are poisoning you. Jeremiah 17, verse number 9. Everybody turn there real quick. Jeremiah chapter 17 and verse number 9. Let me illustrate this here for you as I turn there myself. By the way, as a preacher, I love to preach out of a paper Bible. I'm not against iPads. I'm not against electronics, but I am a forgetful man, and sometimes my phone has died on me before. So I just am cautious, and I preach out of paper because paper doesn't need batteries. All right. Jeremiah 17, verse 9. The heart is deceitful of all things and desperately wicked. Who can know that? That's the opposite of Hollywood's message, isn't it? Matthew 15, now in verse number 19, Matthew chapter 15 and verse number 19. For out of the heart proceed evil thoughts, murders, adulteries, fornications, thefts, false witness, blasphemies. How'd all that get in there? Sounds like somebody left the bottle uncorked and left the cap off on top of that bottle, right? Somebody let some stuff and poison get in there. How'd those flies get in the ointment? How'd that bottle get compromised? How did the heart get all those poison things in there? The answer is that somehow demons and the devil had his way with that heart of ours, and he poured in all those murders and blasphemies and envying. So, what was God's answer at the hands of demons? What did God send to protect your heart? Everyone say it, righteousness.
Righteousness.
The breastplate in the armor of God in Ephesians chapter 6 was the breastplate of righteousness. Righteousness protects your heart. Righteousness is a word that you may not hear in popular Christianity right now. But let me tell you, righteousness matters. We live in a very unrighteous nation. But my father quoted this verse to me when I was very small. Righteousness exalteth a nation. We need in the United States of America a revival of righteousness. I don't care what Hollywood culture says. We need a revival of righteousness. Right is still right. Wrong is still wrong. Hell is real and so is heaven. There is a will of God. There is right. There is still morality. There is still virtue. And there is still justice in the eyes of God. We need righteousness. I must say, I don't want to submit my life in the moral compass of my heart to current cultural trends. There is a moral absolute. It's found right here in God's holy word. This is my compass, and this is my measuring line. I need righteousness in our modern culture. It guards my heart, and it keeps the hand of hell off of me. So if you are a parent, you are not being mean or cruel by setting guards on your home. I'm going to say that a second time here. If you're a parent, you're not being mean or cruel by setting boundaries and guards and guardrails in your house. If you say, we don't do that here in this house, you're not being unkind. You are fortifying righteousness in your house. You're doing the will of God. You're guarding the hearts of your sons and your daughters and even your own life. Everyone say it again. Righteousness.
Righteousness.
It guards your heart. Unrighteousness opens your heart to emotional poisons and corruptions that'll cancel your anointing. But righteousness keeps the purity and the mind of God that the Holy Ghost wants you to have. All right. Third piece of armor. First piece of armor was truth. Truth protects your ability to reproduce. Second piece of armor was righteousness. Righteousness guards your heart. Third piece of armor, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. The third piece of armor is on your feet. I love this because all of this is not the order we'd make this in, is it? We would have protected the head first, and God protected the head in number five. The head, the helmet, is piece number five. The first piece was on reproduction ability. And the second piece is on your heart. And the third piece is on your feet. Your feet. Your feet take you places. Your feet take you into new destinations. Has anyone felt spiritually stuck lately? Has anyone been telling God, Lord, I haven't been able to move? Has anyone been saying, Lord, it feels like I've been gorilla glued down to the same real estate for the last few years in my life? Has anyone been saying, Lord, how do I get unstuck? Well, what protects the moving portions of your body? What protects the soles of your feet to help you then walk into new locations? The answer is peace. Peace. The angels sang out in chorus to shepherds in Luke chapter 2. And on earth peace, goodwill toward men. I wore a wise man necktie tonight. Yes, because I believe in the birth of Jesus. Yes, because I love the story of the wise men, but also because I want to emphasize this point about the birth of Jesus. The angels sang out the words, and on earth peace. It was part of the mission of Jesus to bring peace on earth. Jesus was not called the Prince of War. Jesus was called the Prince of Peace. Jesus spoke to the waves, peace be still, and the seas became a calm. I believe the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, and peace. In the Beatitudes, in the first opening verses of Matthew chapter 5, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Peace is one of the most under-preached issues of the apostolic church. Yes, I believe in spiritual warfare, but for all of my personal belief system about spiritual warfare, I believe that God's will is for you to have peace. And if I am absorbed in conflicts, and if I am mentally and emotionally focused on fightings and wars and verbal wrestlings and arguments, then I can become stuck and unmoved and just hindered in my emotion in the course of life. And what can unstick me and what can get me going again is a revelation of God's anointed peace. It is the will of God for somebody in this Christmas season to recommit themselves to a life of godly peace and to bury the conflicts and to bury the bitterness and jealousies and any things that have stuck you for the last few seasons of your life. I challenge everybody who is listening to this right now and in the future in this recording to pray right now. Pray for the peace of God to end conflict, to end fighting, to end anything, even justifications for it, even to end the lattice work of arguments that you feel have upheld you in the rightness of these wrong verbal warfares. Now, from this point onward, make the resolution of peace as you enter this new year. Say in Jesus' name. Hebrews 12 and 14. Follow peace with all men, and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. And normally, when we apostolics quote that verse, we quote it as, blah, 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 and holiness, and we skip the peace part. But biblical holiness is impossible without biblical peace. Let me repeat that. True biblical holiness is impossible without true biblical peace. Peace is first there in Hebrews 12 and 14. Follow peace with all men. Wait a minute. I got to have peace with everybody? Ooh. Now, there may be some folks you find it nigh impossible to have peace with. If you've done what you can, then you've done what you can. But do what you can. Follow peace with all men. You can't guarantee what they're going to follow, and you can't command what they're going to do. But as for me and my house, we're not going to participate in conflict. We're not going to start herbal wars on the World Wide Web. We're not going to start making telephone calls to try and kill somebody and kill somebody's ministry and do this and assassinate this apostolic over here and over there. I can't control what somebody else does. But as for me, I must follow peace. I can follow peace, which means peace goes first, and I am following it along, doesn't it? It means peace is actually leading me, because peace is a person. There is a Prince of Peace, and if I'm following Jesus, then I'm following peace. Amen. Peace precedes the holiness of God. If anyone feels like you've had gaps in the wall, if you feel like there are elements of holiness consecration that you feel at times are not working for you, or you're even struggling with it, let me speak these anointed words to you. You will find it easier to live a holy life if you first make the effort to have peace. If you first commit yourself to the peace of God, holiness will be a whole lot easier. In Jesus' name. All right. Number four. So number three was peace on your feet. Number four, above all, having the shield of faith. I love that. I love that faith is my shield. See, if I was writing this, I would write this differently. And if we were writing this, a lot of us would write this differently. We would write the word of God as the shield. He would think the word was the shield, and we think faith is the sword that we hit somebody else with. He would think faith is a hammer to knock somebody else on the head with. He would think faith is the spear to launch out at somebody else and just throw that dagger across the World Wide Web and throw that spear on the internet of faith. Faith is not a spear. Faith is not a knife to stab somebody with. Faith is not a sword to make an open wound with. It's a shield. It's a shield to protect you with. What did soldiers do with that shield? I don't know how many of you are familiar with ancient warfare, but soldiers would use shields in groups. There was something in Greece called a phalanx. The Greek phalanx, they would use shields in a coordinated manner. So they would have a soldier and then a soldier, and their shields would interlock. Those shields would interlock as one solid unit. And as long as every soldier had their shield, not only could the enemy not touch the soldier individually, but the enemy could not touch the entire regiment. Good point, Sister Krogh. The Romans had a similar formation. Yes, this was a known thing in ancient world battles. They would interlock their shields so that the enemy could not touch one individual soldier, but the enemy could not touch the entire line. The enemy could not touch the entire front and rear second line of that battle formation. The entire army of that group was protected. The entire army regiment was protected as long as every soldier had their shield. I'm preaching to somebody right here on the World Wide Web that your shield is protecting your brother as well. As long as your shields, as long as you're all having faith together, I need you. You need me. We're all locked together in God's army. Praise God. As long as our faith is united, there's power in unity. As long as we all believe together, wherever there are two or three that are gathered together in the name of Jesus, there he is in the midst of them. For two or three lock arms and lock in and bind together as anything, it shall be done. Right? Faith in groups is powerful. Faith united is powerful. The shield is not simply an individual discussion. It is a corporate whole regiment army discussion. You all have your shields together. The enemy can't touch you or anybody else connected to you in your battle group. Somebody shout praise wherever you are. The shield of faith, wherewith you shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. If you ever see a reenactment of this, ancient warriors in ancient wars didn't just fire arrows Robin Hood style. They didn't just fire a bow and arrow like a bow hunter would who's hunting animals in the modern times either. They would actually dip the tips of their arrows in flammable liquids and fire a flaming arrow at somebody, where even if the arrow was blocked by the shield, the arrow would light everything on fire that it landed in. That was a medieval and ancient world battle technique, because even if the arrow got stopped, it was still on fire and would catch everything that was flammable around it on fire. And so hell's plan is, even if it can't touch you, it wants to light your life on fire. That's why the burning bush metaphor is so powerful. The bush in Exodus chapter 3, I feel the Holy Ghost right here for somebody. The bush was on fire, but was not consumed. Hell wants to light you on fire, but yet all the same, you are not consumed. That burning bush in Exodus chapter 3 was a figure of Moses. Moses had everything in his life lit on fire, and yet he was not consumed. He was raised in Egypt, but all that lit on fire. It picked up on the runs of the wilderness, right? Moses learned the best Egyptian scholars of his day. He learned probably how to write in hieroglyphics. He learned how to be a politician, raised in Pharaoh's court. All that got lit on fire. There may be things in your life that get lit on fire, but as long as you have the shield of faith, you are not consumed. As long as you have your faith, you are not burned to ash. As long as your faith remains strong, the flames of hell cannot touch you. As long as your belief has not been compromised, then you are not consumed. You are not burned. You are not torched into ash. As long as I believe the flames of hell cannot touch me or burn me up. In Jesus' name. All right. There's more on that shield of faith, but I want to hurry. Brother Olette in Boston, Massachusetts, told me something great about shields years ago. There are offensive uses of shields. Shields would get used offensively in medieval warfare. If you were a soldier and an enemy got too close to you, you took that shield and you went bump, and you'd bump that enemy soldier back. The shield had offensive uses. The shield was not just a defensive weapon. It was also an offensive weapon. The shield could be used offensively. If somebody got too close to you, if an enemy got close enough to use their short sword and stab you, or their long sword and touch you, you'd use your own shield and you'd go whap and knock them back. So sometimes I want you, in Jesus' name, to take that shield and whap the enemy back out of your personal bubble. You know what? I believe, whack, I believe, whack. The enemy doesn't get to tell me what I'm going to think today in my mind. Whack. The enemy does not dictate what is in my heart. Whap. The enemy is getting too close to me. Whap. Get out of my face, devil. Whap. I believe in the promises of God in my life. You don't get to get that close to me in my life in this day. Whack. Get back, devil. I believe in God. Shield of faith. Fifth piece of armor. Finally, the helmet of salvation. The mind. This is one of the more obvious pieces of armor. The mind. What protects my holy mind? See, there are days, I want you to think about this. Why isn't the shield of faith enough? Why isn't the shield of faith enough just to have a shield of faith and just stand behind it? Let me tell you why. Because sometimes you're going to peek your head over on top of that shield into places you shouldn't be looking at. Sometimes your head's going to take you into vulnerable places. Sometimes your head is going to take you into vulnerable mental space. Sometimes your thoughts are going to make you wander into places that are above the actual protection of the shield of faith. Some days you're going to have thoughts that are just so out there and crazy that you won't know what to do with yourself. So what do you do in those moments? You rely on this bottom line thought. God has saved me. Even on days where you feel like you are not enough and you're not doing enough, especially in the times where you feel like that you haven't done enough that you should have, even on the moments where you say, you know what? I'm not perfectly right as I should be. I need to align myself in God. Even still, God has not erased your name from the Lamb's Book of Life. On those days, even on top of the shield of faith, you have the helmet of salvation that hell can't touch your mind. The helmet also protects something very important. I'm going to throw some biology and some anatomy at you. The ears for hearing, and the eyes for seeing, and the nose for the olfactory sense of smell, and the tongue for the taste sense. Four out of the five senses have their central operation from the head. So your ability to feel, four out of five senses are located in the head. You also have touch. So in one sense, five out of five senses all operate at the head. So hell also wants to attack your ability to feel. Hell wants to make you feel numb. You know, the Holy Ghost directed me here. Somebody has been saying in your private prayer time that you feel numb. You've been saying that you can't feel what to do. And you feel like hell is making you feel senseless and numb. So what restores your spiritual senses to where you can perceive direction again? The answer is you must remember your covenant of salvation, Acts 2:38. I encourage all of you who are listening to this Zoom right now, just say Acts 2:38 right now again in your mind. Then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. The covenant of salvation restores your spiritual senses. It restores you on the days where your mind has made you feel like you're going to lose it. You're safe. You're filled with the Holy Ghost. My head has made me vulnerable sometimes. The thinking in my brain has made me peek outside protection of that shield of faith. But all the same, God's salvation covenant has protected me. And the enemy cannot touch me because I've repented of my sins. I've been baptized in the only name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. I've been baptized in the name of Jesus. And I received the infilling of the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in tongues. The oneness of God is vital. And Acts 2:38 is the salvation plan. Amen. A friend of mine once told me that if you want to have revival, preach the oneness of God, Pastor Freeze. Somebody once told me that years ago. Notice how the head is the fifth thing protected. Now I want to tell you why I've kept mentioning the head and the helmet all throughout this discussion. We give way too much conversation to what goes on in our headspace. We focus way too much on the gunk that happens between our ears right here. There are Christian books on the talk about winning the battle of the mind, and it is something important. Let me also give a counterbalance to this. There can be times when we overfocus on what's going on in our head. God has the other four pieces of armor first. The loins piece, your spiritual reproduction ability that is guarded by truth. He has your heart protected by righteousness. He has your feet, your motion and moving protected by peace. And he has the rest of you guarded by faith. He has four other elements that he guards before he even broaches the subject of what happens in your head. Don't become a Christian that dominates your talk on what is happening inside your head. In fact, this may sound hard, but get out of your head. Get out of your head. Don't spend all of your waking hours about what could happen and what is happening between two ears right here. There's a life to live in God. There are souls to be saved. God is calling you to motion and movement in the kingdom of God. Everyone say, in Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Get out of your head. All right. One more verse I'll quote about this, about the heart and the head. For both the heart and the head, the second piece and the fifth piece. 1 John 3:20, for if our heart condemn us, God is greater than our heart. On days when your head and your heart are telling you weird and crazy junk, read 1 John 3:20, for if our heart condemn us, God is greater than our heart. Stick to that verse and use that sword verse in 1 John 3:20. Final piece of armor, the sword. The sword. The sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. I would have thought the Word would be our shield. It's not. If you go back to Genesis, God told Abraham in Genesis, I am thy shield and thy exceeding great reward. God is our shield in a very deep biblical sense. Faith, belief in him is our shield. But the Word of God is our first purely offensive weapon. The Word, the sword of the Spirit. How do I actually do damage to the enemy? What did Jesus do when Satan himself came to him three times in the wilderness? He quoted the Word, right? How do you beat back satanic and demonic attacks? With the Word. How do you hurt hell? With this. Probably why you've been attacked every time you open up the Word of God. Probably I'm giving revelation to somebody right here. The reason why somebody gets attacked every time you try and resolve to read the Bible, you feel like stuff gets in your way. That's why. Because the Word hurts hell. The Word hurts demonic attack. The rest of the other five pieces are essentially defensive pieces. But when you quote the Word, when you eat this book, when you read the Word, when you believe the Word, when you apply the Word, when you live the Word, when you use the Word, when you speak the Word, when you pray the Word, when you preach the Word and put it out there on your social media accounts, you are hurting the efforts of hell and demons all around you. And for all of those defensive elements, now you can hurt the army of hell. And do you notice how the first five pieces are defensive? See, God totally and completely protects you before he even has the conversation about hurting hell. The main goal of God is not just to hurt hell. If God wanted to do that, he just rained down stuff on them. The main goal of God is about you. You are more important than actually doing damage to hell. Helping you, growing you, protecting you, working in you is more important than God to God than anything else in the conversation about demonic stuff. God wants to keep you safe first. The parent's job, any mother and any father listening to this recording, your most important job when you have that baby is protect the baby first, right? Well, you're God's baby. You're God's child. You're God's son and God's daughter. You're his first conversation. Before that mother or father does anything else, they make sure their children are safe. And then they have other conversations. And so now that God has made sure that you're safe, now let's talk about hurting hell. In this Christmas season, put this book to practice. When you live, preach, speak, absorb, eat, and grow deeper in this word, when you live this word right here, you are doing something powerful. You are doing something authoritative in the kingdom of God. Jesus said that he is the living bread and the living word in the Gospels, didn't he? Something is powerful. Something transpires when you put this book to practice and when you quote the word of God. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my pathway. God said his word is a light. It is no accident that light has a father, you know. God called himself the father of light. In Genesis 1, God was the one who spoke light into existence. Let there be light. And he said that you are light. You are light. You are his sons. He has spoken you into existence as well. He is the light of the world. And that Father of light is still speaking light into existence. He wants you to go and shine that light everywhere that you are. Speak that word. Speak that light. Be that light. Be salt of the earth and be that light wherever you are. Last point. There is one defensive use of swords that I have seen. If you ever see sword play or if you ever see sword fights, there's something called parrying. When two swords are clashing, when one person is trying to deal a death blow and bringing their sword down on somebody else, the other swordman will bring their sword and use the sword to block that opposing sword. Parrying in sword fights, they use a sword to block the offensive swordman opposing them. They'll actually block that sword death blow with their sword. So there are defensive uses of the sword. You can stop the enemy's death blows. This book right here. Wherever you are right now, I want you to have a moment of prayer with me. Lord God, let me put into practice your armor. Clothe me. Uphold me with your truth and righteousness. I take, Lord God, first of all, your truth. Truth is the foundational piece. It protects and guards my ability to bring forth a new generation of Christians. If I veer off truth, I can't reproduce myself. I become spiritually sterile. But I want to tell somebody else about the Acts 2:38 message. God, I put on the breastplate of righteousness. Guard my heart, Lord God. Out of it are the issues of life. God, put peace upon my feet. Without peace, I become spiritually stuck and unable to move. But with the peace of God, I can move forward. You can lead me in the paths of righteousness for your name's sake, according to that 23rd Psalm, when I have peace shodding my feet. You can lead me beside the still waters and in righteous paths when I have peace protecting my feet. Peace giving me that ability in God. I receive faith. Faith is my shield that blocks hell's ability to light my life on fire. And even if some things do burn, like everything did in Moses' life, Still I will survive, and the enemy shall not burn me alive, because the shield of faith quenches the fire of the enemy. The shield of faith quenches all the flaming darts, the fiery darts of the devil and demons. Salvation, I receive it as a protection on my holy mind. I will not become spiritually insane. I am grounded. My mind is grounded by your word in the Acts 2:38 covenant of salvation. Salvation protects my spiritual sensibility and my ability to feel God and sense and feel direction on what I should do. My spiritual, I'm going to say it again, my spiritual feeling, my spiritual sensibility and ability to sense future motion and direction in God and what I should do is protected by salvation. And sixthly and finally, my one purely offensive ability as a warrior I receive is your word, Lord God. Your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Your word is truth. Your word is vital. Your word is precious. I need your word in my life, Lord God. Speak the word in me. Let me speak the word wherever I go. The word is my ability to do damage to hell and demonic forces around me. It's why hell hates it whenever we quote the Bible. It's why hell hates it whenever I read the Bible. I need more of this book. I need more of your word in me. Every time we operate in your word, Lord God, we hurt demonic attack and we hurt the hand of hell in our communities and our households. I receive all this. We all say in Jesus' name.
Jesus.
Amen.
Jesus.
I want to add one comment, brother. You mentioned to somebody out on the internet that's having trouble with their mind. Proverbs 16:3 says, commit your works unto the Lord, and your thoughts shall be established.
Where is that?
If we'll follow what the preacher had to say, and we'll follow what the word has to say, and we'll just do it, God will establish our thoughts. He will clear out our thinking. The Spirit comes with the lifestyle.
Hallelujah.
Proverbs 16:3, commit your works unto the Lord, and your thoughts shall be established.
Praise God.
Running there right now. Yeah. Commit your works unto the Lord. I like that.
We greatly appreciate our brother and his message tonight.
Thank you. Oh, I felt God so strong.
We greatly appreciate everybody that we so dearly love on here tonight.
Thank you all. Thank you for the opportunity to be here with you. Thank you for the good comments too. Anybody who needs any of the verses, just message me and I can try and get the verse list to you as well.
And I'm also going to put a word on here for precious Pastor Baldwin, who will be picking this up on the internet later. God bless you, sir. We missed you tonight.
Yes.
But our name's improving.
All right. I'm going to turn off the recording.